So now we're going to talk about tissues, histology. So tissues are just what groups of what?
Cells.
Yeah, different cells, different types of cells, if we're working together for one common goal, that's a tissue. Histology is what? Do you remember from the first day?
Study of tissues.
Study of tissues. So there are two reasons that tissues reproduce or build on each other. And one's to create the individual or the new organism, and the second is to fix things. Did we talk about this briefly last week? Okay, perfect. It's a brand new material. So initially when you're building these tissues and building organs, two reasons, like I said. There's either to make the organism, which all starts from exactly the same DNA. You have one cell that was created by a sperm and an egg, and all the DNA that's in there is all the DNA you'll ever have. And that DNA replicates from one cell to two cells to four cells, 8, 16, 32, 64, and just keeps replicating over and over and over again. So you have a whole organism. But these different cells, they grow into different types of cells, and there are over 200 different types of cells that will, almost 200 types, we'll talk about this semester, and next semester is fine. So even though they have the same DNA, they're all individual. And the other reason is to regenerate. So these tissues, they come together to regenerate to make or fix things. Like we'll talk about the immune system. I think we'll start it on Monday. I forgot that we didn't have school this last Monday, so we're going to be like one day behind. But integument system will start on Monday. Here's a really good example of how tissues regenerate. So all these individual cells, they're holding hands. If you get damage to it, they start replicating and filling in until you completely fix or patch up the tissue. From biology, you need to remember the life cycle. So I'm going to kind of go through this briefly and show you the pieces that you have to know or have to have memorized. So the life cycle, if you look at a cell, you draw a circle. Most of the cycle is called interphase. When a cell is ready to replicate or become a tissue, when it makes a copy of itself, it starts right here at the beginning of interphase, and it goes through three special phases. First one is G1. It's a growth phase. I would kind of think of this like pregnancy. When we get pregnant, first stage here, growth, taking lots of materials, starting to build this new organism. So the cell's starting to take in lots of materials. Amino acids to build proteins, it's taking in lipids, it's taking in carbohydrates. When it has all the raw materials it needs, it goes through a checkpoint to make sure it has everything, and it goes to the next phase called S phase. In this phase, it synthesizes. DNA. Bless you. It takes all the DNA that cell has and copies everything in it. Synthesizes. Once it has all that DNA copied, then it goes through another phase, G2. So the second phase, another growth phase, not as substantial as the first one, but it's more mild. And it's almost like the same thing with pregnancy. You get through, you develop all of the organs. At the very end, really what the baby's doing in utero is just eating lots of proteins and fats just to build the size a little bit bigger. So everything's already there. You're just making sure you have all the raw materials for birth. As soon as you get through all three of these phases, or the stages of interphase, then you go through mitosis. Mitosis is like the birth itself. So you've gone through all this long interphase, and now you're ready to take that cell and rip it into two cells. It's really brief. And here's the phase that you have to know. So all these I'm going to draw. You might want to doodle them in your notes. I'm just going to give you the significant points or the highlights that you need to remember from biology. The first phase is called prophase. So with prophase, one of the things you're going to notice, in the book, your book goes and breaks down early and late prophase. You learned all that in biology. As long as you remember the main points, I'm fine with this. First thing that happens is nuclear breakdown. So more specifically, the nuclear envelope. Nuclear envelope starts dissolving, starts falling apart. The second major thing you notice with prophase is DNA condense. So normally the cell looks this. The nucleus is dark all over the place with a dark area in it called the nucleolus.
But as it starts replicating, all this DNA starts coiling up really, really tight, and it looks like a bunch of little tiny worms inside. So once the DNA is all condensed, then two little structures called centrioles move to the poles. And it starts metaphase. And with metaphase, the most significant thing is that all of the DNA, all the chromosomes, all line up across the equator. Imagine it's like a little planet. You see all the DNA, the chromosomes lining up across the middle. And they call it the plate. It's not just a straight line, it's actually like a disc. Because remember, the cell is three-dimensional. It's hard to draw that on a board. But all of the DNA lines up right along the center. So if you tilted the cell and looked sideways, you could actually see it's more spread out like a plate. Straight line. So, chromosomes, the DNA, aligned at plate, where you can think of the equator. All these chromosomes are connected to those centrioles. Suddenly, the moment is these centrioles start pulling really hard and tugging on all the chromosomes, and they rip. It's called anaphase. And the significance there are the chromosomes rip and move to the poles. So if you imagine these centrioles as the North Pole and the South Pole, they start pulling the ripped halves of DNA towards opposite poles. The most significant thing about telophase is its shape. Telophase looks more like a peanut to me. And the characteristics, this dimple on both sides here, it's called a cleavage furrow. Cytokinesis, some books group it right along with telophase, is when the two cells separate.
So like I said, I'm not going to go through and go with every single detail, but those are the most significant ones. And this is mitosis. What's the other thing that starts with an M that's very similar to this process? Meiosis. And now always remember that with mitosis, you're making twin cells. So whatever the cell looked like in the very beginning, its daughter cell is going to look exactly like it. So both of these are exact. Everything about them is exactly the same. The other one, meiosis, M-E-I-O-S-I-S. I always stress the I because they're all individuals. So if you went through a process just like this called meiosis, at the very end you'd have two daughter cells, but they're very different. In fact, they're totally different. The only time you worry about meiosis is when you're producing gametes, or the reproductive cells, like the egg and the sperm. Because every egg and every sperm is an individual. No two are alike. So, like, when a man ejaculates, there are about 250 million sperm in there. All of them are individual, and they're all from meiosis. When you have to repair skin or tissues, like I was talking about earlier, when you use mitosis, every skin cell is exactly like the one right next to it. These are all twins. They go through mitosis. And then I just put some of the slide pictures in to show what's happening. So here are the textbook pictures. You can see with prophase, oops, I just kind of grouped them together. You can see early prophase, the chromosomes are condensing lightly, and now they're extremely striking. Metaphase, all the chromosomes, remember, in this bluey purple color, they're lined up right across the equator, the center. Anaphase, they just ripped. Telophase, you have the cleavage furrow, and you can see two new nuclei forming. And then cytokinesis, they ripped completely apart. Wanted, I put this in for practice, and this is where you could do some labeling. And then cellular diversity, like I said, over 200 different types of cells, and it all starts from when an egg meets a sperm. So half the chromosomes come from sperm, half from the egg. They meet up, they form this brand new organism, and that organism starts replicating through mitosis. So you'll see it go from being one structure to two cells, and it would go to four, and then eight, and just keep replicating like that over and over again. So finally you have this new organism. And later in the semester, actually not until next semester, we'll talk about embryology and how every step of this progresses. Skip over that. All right, so 200 different types of cells. Some of the cells we'll look at sperm cells, we'll look at an egg, so an ova from an ovary. We'll look at red blood cells. When you look at the different shapes, different cells have different shapes because they have specific purposes. The one thing that they all have in common is they all have the same DNA in your body, except the red blood cell. The red blood cell doesn't have a nucleus that has any DNA, so there are no blueprints, which means it can't replicate, it can't fix itself, which means that it also has a shelf life. And we'll talk about the red blood cells next semester. With structures, you can see like a smooth muscle. It's designed so they can track and pull things. Nervous tissue. Long electrical signals go from one area to the next, communication. Epithelial cells are built kind of like puzzle pieces so that they can stack right into each other and lock in. Like your skin is covered in epithelium, all the cells lock together. If you get a sunburn and you start peeling your skin after that, you can see how all of them lock together. But they all have the same DNA. Cell differentiation, the term, is just talking about how cells take a different shape and how they rearrange or they use different types of organelles. They all have the same organelles, but the amounts that they need are different. Like, for instance, mitochondria, what does that do? Makes energy, ATP. So a cell like a nervous cell, a neuron that uses lots and lots of energy, you might see a ton of mitochondria. For an epithelial cell that barely uses any energy at all, you see barely any mitochondria in it. The shape of the cells and the arrangement of the organelles are what cell differentiation is. Some of the ones we'll look at this semester, again, I already started talking about them, but erythrocytes, fancy word for red blood cells, fibroblasts, and watch the words. If the word that doesn't look familiar or looks tricky, fibroblast. Blast means maker. Guess what it's making? Fibers. Yeah, it's telling you it's literally making fibers. So you can see the cells are designed almost like spiders so that they can spin this web and create a matrix or an environment for other cells. Erythro means red. What do you think cyte mean? Cells, yep, red cells. Epithelial cells, like I was talking about, they're designed so they can stack right next to each other. Not just linearly, but in a long, continuous sheet. Like, even on your skin, it goes all the way around, wraps around, and connects. There's no breaks. Hopefully there are no breaks. Fat cells, when we're talking about organelles, fat cells have all the normal organelles, but some characteristic about them is they have this huge wad of fat. So it's a gigantic wad. So you can see a nucleus smashed over here, all the organelles will be smashed to the side. It's just like a big droplet of fat. It's a storage container. A macrophage. Phage means eat. What do you think macro means? Large. It's a big eater. So it's a white blood cell that goes along eating big things like bacteria. It grabs hold of bacteria, wraps itself completely around. So its structures, it uses its cytoskeleton to reshape itself and actually make structures called podocytes, where it grabs a hold of your blood vessel wall or your tissue wall, grabs hold of it and pulls, and then makes a new foot and pulls again. And it just pulling and pulling and pulling. It's kind of a unique feature for macrophage. Not many cells in your body are mobile once they find their destination. We'll look at muscle cells. Like I said, they're designed for contraction. Different types of muscle cells are all for contraction, but they have different types of contraction. So you'll see the shapes are a little bit different. Like if you look in your bicep, the skeletal muscle, it's a long cylinder, like a tube. But if you look at your GI tract, they're usually little spindle-shaped cells. We'll talk about why that is later. The neuron for the nervous system, sending electrical signals from one area all the way to the next. So a neuron can talk from one neuron to the next, almost like a, well, I don't know if you guys did this when you were kids, but having two cans, like canned food cans, and you take a long string and tighten it. If you talk in one, it sends a signal all the way across the string to the other one. Same idea with the nervous cells. You talk into one area, or you send a signal in one area, it goes all the way down until it gets to the other area. So they have to have that long tube-shaped structure called an axon. And then sperm cells, another one of those unique cells that can move through the body. So it has a long structure called a flagella, which is the only structure in the entire human body that has a flagella. And only men get them, so haha. So all those different cells, 200 types of cells, when you find any groups of cells that work together for one purpose, you have your tissue. These are the four main tissue types. I would commit them totally to memory. Just saying. And these are the types we'll talk about today, tomorrow, and on Friday. So epithelia, and I always like to think of, I try to think of things in the simplest terms that I possibly can. You can go through and have a whole page description of epithelial tissue, but the easiest way to describe it is a sheet-like covering. They always form sheets. Epithelial tissue always forms a sheet, continuous sheet. Like your skin, the surface of your skin is all epithelium. It forms this sheet that goes all the way around your body. We'll talk about the GI tract, and it's a long sheet that's like a tube that goes all the way through your body. So I always think sheet-like covering. I'm going to skip over connective tissue and come back to it. Muscle always contract. That's their purpose. Muscles are there for contraction. Nervous tissues, long distance communication. And then I skip over connective tissue because if you look at a cell, if it fits in a category where it forms a sheet, it's epithelium. If you find a tissue that's main purpose is to contract, it's a muscle. If the main purpose is long-distance communication, it's nervous. Connective tissue is other. Anything that didn't fit into the other three groups goes into connective tissues. Like, for instance, red blood cells. They carry oxygen. They're not a sheet. They don't contract. They're not long-distance communication, so they must be connective tissue. Bones aren't sheets. Bones are a bunch of cells stacked on each other, but they don't form a sheet. So they're not epithelium. They don't move your body, they form the scaffolding for your body. They don't actually do contraction. And they're not there for long-distance communication, so bone tissue is going to be connective tissue, or bone cells are connective tissues. And that's, I think this just froze. And then don't forget, tissues form organs. So if I take those four tissues and put them together, just look at your, take the bicep. So when you look at the bicep has muscle tissue. It has to be controlled by the brain, so what other tissue do you automatically know is going to be involved? Nervous tissue. Yeah, the communication from the brain comes down to the arm. It has connective tissue flowing through it, like blood flowing through it. It also has connective tissue webbing all through it. So multiple tissues for one purpose, an organ. Definitely know the tissue types, and we're going to go through and look at different parts of the body. When we get to each system, we'll come back through and review the tissues, and we'll review the types of cells. So get to know the different tissue types. So tissues all require teamwork. They have to work together. If any group of those cells inside the tissue starts dying, the whole tissue is going to die. If you want an organ to work, all the organ tissues have to work together. There are 100 trillion cells in the body, and they all have to cooperate. Every one of them. And then here are our descriptions. So, tissues are a collection of cells with similar structure and function, and then histology is a study of the tissues. So if you're looking over here, the four types again, what category did bone fall into? Yeah, connective. It didn't fit into the other three. How about the heart tissue, both of the heart tissue? What's the heart doing? It's contracting and squeezing blood, so what would that be? Muscle. The brain obviously is going to be nervous tissue. And then here you have a sheet of skin going over the ear. What would that be? Epithelium. We'll talk about epithelial tissue very first. And here's just an example of the GI tract. So with the GI tract, you can see this darker red layer here. This is where the food would be up here. It's continuous. It's constantly going along. There are no breaks in it all the way along. If you have projections or long structures in the GI tract, that epithelium just goes right along up out of the picture and back down. No breaks. Why don't you want any breaks in the lining of the GI tract or the lining of the skin? What would happen if you had cuts or breaks in here? Yeah, you risk infection, you could lose fluids, so lots of problems. Okay, so epithelial tissue, its main functions, I said again, when you see something that's protective covering, it's usually going to be epithelial tissue. But its main purpose is protection. It keeps things like moisture in your body, keeps heat in your body. It allows you to cool off when you're too hot. It keeps you warm. It's packed, epithelial tissue is packed with neurons, little tiny ends of, well, nervous tissue for sensations. So all over your skin, you could close your eyes and still feel where you are because of all this sensory function. Diffusion, talked about that briefly, moving things across the membrane. So like your GI tract, you're trying to diffuse in things like nutrients, water, electrolytes like sodium, potassium, chloride. If you rub something that was oil-based or lipid-based on your skin, it can actually diffuse right through your skin. Things that love fats easily get in your body. So when you think of drugs, when people put a patch on them, that drug must be what? Water-loving or fat-loving? Fat-loving. If it's water-loving, it gets blocked. It's like when you're in the bathtub, your skin blocks out the water. But those fat-loving drugs, the fat-loving chemicals, can diffuse right through the membrane. Epithelial tissue is great for absorption, secretion, moving ions. When you see the word ion, I always think another word with it. Ion, and I think electrolyte. Ions are anything that have a plus or minus sign over their symbol. Like Na plus, so Na plus is calcium. Cl minus, chloride. Filtration. When we talk about the kidney, we'll actually talk about absorption and filtration. So it's a really good way to filter things like the blood. Epithelial cells can have little tiny pores between them, so that bad substances can get through, or sometimes good substances for filtration. And they often form slippery surfaces. So where do you think most of the epithelial tissue in your body is going to be found? I'll give you a hint, you can see it when you look at people. Both of the epithelial tissues in the skin. Right. Some terminology that you need to know when you're talking about epithelial tissue, it always has directions. So there's basically a north and a south, an east and a west on a cell. Right. We refer to that as polarity, or it has poles or directions. Epithelial tissue is also avascular. I mentioned this, I think, the first day of class, or the second day of class. What's vascular referring to? Vessels. Yep, it's referring to the vessels. So if you're A, you put A at the beginning of a word, what's it mean? Without. So it doesn't have something. So avascular means that all epithelial tissue doesn't have blood vessels. No epithelial tissue has blood vessels. The surface of your skin, no blood vessels in the surface of the skin. The most superficial or the closest to the outside of the body, that layer is all epithelium and there's no blood vessels. I don't know if you were one of these kids, but did you ever take a safety pin and slide it just under your skin? And then you pull it out and it doesn't bleed or anything? Or if you didn't do that, it happened to the cool kids. And you got a paper cut. You ever had a paper cut that didn't bleed? Because it just went through the epithelium. It has to get down deep like this. Here's your epithelium. That paper cut would have to go all the way through the epithelium and actually hit the connective tissue layer underneath. And we'll talk about that actually a lot when we talk about skin. Another big one, high regeneration. And it may not seem like it's so significant, but these things replicate really fast. They go through mitosis frequent and fast. It's like your skin. You you're always making brand new skin. You're turning it over really, really quick, constantly. There's a problem with that, though. Any cells that replicate really fast, if they mutate or change, like if they became a cancer, what's that tell you about the cancer? Now the cancer is going to regenerate really fast, and it's problematic. The most common cancer out there is skin cancer. If you take all the cancers combined, other than skin cancer, combine them all in a year, it still doesn't equal the number of skin cancers in a year. So why is it you don't hear about people constantly dying of skin cancer? Yeah, we're vain, right? So we see anything that looks abnormal, we go, ooh, ugly, cut it off, and it's gone. It doesn't get a chance to grow, usually. When we talk about skin, I'll show you some people that let it go a little bit too long, but yeah, there are a lot more skin cancers than any other type of cancer, but they're easy to treat, they're easy to recognize. Right, and then they have specialized connections that we're going to talk about. So you can see it's actually really complex, all of these connective areas along the cell, from one to the next. So epithelial cells, they all hold hands. Here are the types of connections you have to know. I'm sorry, did I stress that? You have to know them. So the first one's called a tight junction. Tight junctions, they don't let anything pass through. They're not that strong. They're kind of like Velcro between the cells. Maybe the next slide has it, yeah. So the tight junctions are kind of like Velcro. You can see all those little button spots so that they can snap together and hold on together. They're great because they're waterproof, but they're not that strong. Here's the close-up. If you saw the inside of the GI tract, it would look something like this in the intestine, small intestine. And then between all the cells, you have all these little tight junctions that are waterproofing. Second ones, adhesion junctions, and a special name you need to remember is called a desmosome. It should be written right in the notes. Yeah, desmosome. Right, so the desmosomes are really, really strong. They always remind me of concrete driveways. I remember watching when my parents had a driveway put in. They don't just pour concrete. Anybody ever seen what they do before they pour the concrete into the driveway? They frame it up, the shape of the driveway, and they put something else in there before they actually put the concrete down. Rebar, yeah, the wiring. That wire stuff, the metal sticks, whatever you want to call them. But the same thing here. You have these protein-like rebar going all the way through. So you have a strong connection between the two cells. But then you pour a concrete plaque over. It's actually a calcified plaque to make it even stronger. They're really strong. So when you see a tissue that needs a lot of strength, like the heart, heart muscles are constantly, well, if you're lucky, they're pulling every second of the day, tugging as strong as they possibly can on each other. You'll find a lot of these desmosomes in the heart muscle. And then the last one is the gap junctions. Gaps, they're exactly gaps. They're holes between two cells. So you have a hole that's connecting this cell to the next one. It's nice mainly because it's a fast communication. This cell can talk directly with this cell by sending a signal right through that hole. So when we see something like the small intestines, groups of cells all contract at one time to squeeze your food or propel your food. So in this situation where you have smooth muscle, they all need to talk to each other to send food at the same time so we can smash the food. So gaps are little holes or pores that connect to the cells. They're not super strong. They're not waterproofing. They're mainly there for communication from one cell to the next. And I put this in, it was from another textbook that just shows the three of them again. Tight junctions, you can see how they peel off. You can see the desmosomes with the linker proteins, and then the gap junctions where one cell can talk to another. Right. A special type of epithelial tissue is called glandular epithelium, and it makes glands. And there are two types of glands you have to know. And I didn't bold them, but you might want to highlight them. There's endocrine and exocrine. Guess which one pushes outside of the body? Yeah, exocrine. So when you look at epithelium, it's continuous. It doesn't break, but it does fold. So if you have a straight line going along, you might see it bend down in, make a special gland, come back up, and then move along. So if this were a, we'll say an oil gland on your skin, you make the oils, you push it in, and you push it out to the outside of the body. Would that be endocrine or exocrine? Exocrine. But if you look on the inside of the body,
you have epithelium on blood vessels. Right next to that epithelium on the blood vessels, you might get a special gland that separates itself off and pushes stuff into the blood, the internal environment. What would that be? Yep, and endocrines makes special structures called hormones.
So you automatically associate endocrine with hormones. So they secrete things into the blood as chemical messengers to travel all over the body. They don't push anything outside the body. If it's endo, it's telling you it's pushing it within.
Usually when you say you're pushing something within or you're trying to get something into the body, you're trying to get into the blood. Whether you're trying to eat food or you're drinking water or you're filtering your kidneys and you're trying to pull things back into your body, you're pulling it back into the blood. Exocrine, like an oil gland, pushes outside.
Another characteristic of epithelium is it always has a layer underneath it called the basement membrane. The base membrane glues the epithelium down. It's just a long sheet. So if it were just, if I had a piece of plastic and I stuck it on your table, it could easily slide back and forth across the table. If I want to make it secure, I glue it down. And the basement membrane is the glue. So for instance, here you can see the epidermis, the surface of the skin. It's going to be glued down or connected to the layer below it by a basement membrane. Here you can see epithelium along the, this is the airway. So here are all these cells holding hands. They're all tightly connected, forming a sheet, their epithelium. Right along the bottom of that sheet, you can see this thin layer called the basement membrane that glues this whole epithelial layer down to the connective tissues. So it connects the upper layers or the epithelial layers to the underlying tissues, basement membrane. The next several slides you absolutely positively have to memorize. So another thing we describe epithelial tissues with is their shape and the number of layers they have. Shape and the number of layers. So when we name an epithelial tissue, the naming system is usually pretty easy. Took this cell and we boxed it, made it kind of square, like a what?
Cube.
Cube, yeah. We call it cuboidal. And a third one, if we stretch it out really tall, like a column, call it columnar. Pretty simple. Usually the one that gets people is the squamous. I think squashed.
The second descriptive term is how many layers. This is even easier. If it's simple, it has one layer. It's just one simple layer. If it has two or more layers, we call it stratified. So down here, the types of epithelium we're going to look at or talk about. Here you have one layer of flat cells. That would be, how many layers is what you say first. One is simple, and because it's flattened or squashed, it's squamous. And anywhere you want to find diffusion, things moving back and forth, you have simple squamous. Here you have the same thing, one layer, simple, but cube shape, one layer, but columnar. Two tricky ones that have special names. You have one that's called transitional because guess what can it do? It can transition from one type to another. It can change. Like in the bladder, when it starts stretching out the bladder wall, it'll take itself from being columnar and start smashing it down to a more flat shape. And then this last one, pseudostratified, which is going to be on a slide on its own too. Pseudo means what? Does anybody know? Fake. Yep. So pseudostratified is telling you, is it a real stratified layer? Now, what does stratified mean? More than one layer. It says it's pseudostratified, so it's not really stratified. So guess how many layers you're actually looking at? Just one. Yep. And then we'll talk about where they are. So when you're looking at these different types, they all have a function, and their anatomy works with it. So if they're flat and they're one layer thick, you obviously want to get something back and forth really fast. So you might see it at the lungs or the blood vessels. If you see really thick, stratified squamous, lots and lots and lots of layers, you know, 30 layers thick, what do you think that would do for them? It's protective, right? So you might see on the surface of the skin, it's protecting your body. We'll go through and we'll talk again about the organs and the benefits. So the first one is simple squamous epithelium, one layer, flattened, and we're actually going to look at some of these in the microscope tomorrow during the lab time. So you have to, when you're looking at microscope slides, you have to think three-dimensionally. When they slice it, if I had a ball like this and I slice through it, I can't get all the parts of the ball. So if I slice through and I cut it in half, all I'm going to see is right along here where my finger's at, down here where my other part of my finger is, and it's still too thick, so they have another slice that goes across, and all you're going to see are these little fingertips of that ball or edges of the ball. So when you look at something like this, it's the lungs. This was actually a ball-shaped structure, but they sliced straight through it. So maybe you could imagine a watermelon. If you take a slice straight out of the middle of the watermelon, you cut both ends off of it for that center slice, and then you cut all the red part out, you'd have that ring. That's what you're looking at here. So the round alveoli is what it's called. So the round ball-like structure in the lung that holds oxygen, you slice across and you can just see the rim edge of it all the way around. One simple layer thick. So here's one little cell, here's a little cell. You see how they're touching hands or holding hands, their epithelium. They form a sheet, a ball-like sheet, but they're really thin. So ideal for diffusion or movement. Another place you might find this would be blood vessels. What do you think you're trying to get into the tissue in a blood vessel? Why do you think the red blood cell is moving along here? What do red blood cells carry? What do you think they carry? Ooh, nobody had an AMP in high school? Good, it's all brand new. Red blood cells carry oxygen. They carry oxygen, they carry carbon dioxide to help transport waste products out of your body to your lungs and carry oxygen into the tissues. So as the red blood cell is sliding along here, that oxygen has to get out of the red blood cell, go across this simple squamous layer, and get into the tissue. So here you can see a nucleus, there's a nucleus, there's a nucleus. All of these cells are holding hands. And remember, a blood vessel isn't flat like that. It's a round tube. Then they slice it across. You're just seeing the outer edge up here, another outer edge up here, and you're seeing all these red blood cells in between. So a special type of epithelium is called endothelium. It's within the red blood vessels. And then we'll talk about these again tomorrow. But functions, allows things to move back and forth quickly, so small particles travel fast. This is another picture of lungs. You see the sides. If I were to take all these lungs and flatten them out into a sheet and look down at it, this is what they will look like from the top. So you can see this flat cell. Here's another flat cell. What do you think this dark thing is? The nucleus. And when you don't see a nucleus in one of these cells, it's because when they sliced it, they accidentally lost it in this other cell. So you can see all these flat cells with their nucleus in the middle. And then tomorrow we'll draw and label them. Next one's simple cuboidal. So how many layers? One. What's its shape? Cube shape, yep. So again, you have to think three-dimensionally. These are tubes. So here's a tube coming out at you. Just like if you were looking at this marker, it's like this. Got a handful of markers, and you can see them from the side. What happened is they're coming out at you, and then they sliced across. So you're looking down into the marker, down to that hole in the back. The outer layer here, a bunch of cells surrounding that tube. These are simple cuboidal, and you have to kind of imagine, kind of squint a little bit, I guess. Like here's an example. That's somewhat cube-shaped. It's pretty darn close to cube-shaped. Right next to it's another kind of cube. That cube's a little smushed. There's another cube, and they form this ring, this tube. their ideal purpose is secreting things and absorbing things. We'll find them in the kidneys for secreting or getting rid of waste products and also for reabsorbing things you don't want to lose. Like, for instance, when we talk about the kidneys, sugar will actually go into your pre-urine. You accidentally filter sugar out of your blood in your kidney, but the kidney will quickly pull it back in. It will reabsorb it through these simple cuboidal epithelia. So think again with the three-dimensional. Here's a tube. There's the outer layer. There's another outer layer. This is going the length of the tube, so if I hold the marker like this and we sliced across it, if I turn the marker this way, here's the same type of tube. You're just looking down. Here's the open area that's right here, and there are the cells all around it. Another way to think to look for is when you look at cuboidal, the nucleus is almost always round. So it may not be perfect. It may be a little bit off. You still have that nice round nucleus in the middle. They're not always perfect cubes. So you can see the red one here. In general, if you draw right along, it's going to take roughly a cube shape. I'll draw this tomorrow. Simple columnar, one layer of columns. The columns, if you notice, here's a characteristic. The nucleus always sits at an end. The nucleus always wants to sit at the end that has a basement membrane. I always think of it like gravity, which gravity actually doesn't affect this, but I always think of the base membrane as being magnetic or like a gravitational pull. That nucleus wants to pull it all the way down here. So when you see columnar, it's usually all the way at the very bottom. A lot of times, not always, but a lot of times it's not a very round nucleus, it's usually a little bit more oblong or like this. So their purpose is absorption, secretion, making things like mucus. And we're going to see a lot of this along the GI tract and the airways. So here's just another example. You can see all those columns with the kind of weird nucleus down at the bottom. Here's a long chain of them, columns with the weird nucleus at the bottom. And then here's a nice detailed description. So again, tomorrow when you're going through the lab material, you can go back and look. You can actually, while you're looking at it, draw or describe what you're seeing. Next is pseudo-stratified. What did that mean again? Yep, fake stratified. There's only one layer, but it looks like more than one. It's really a rare tissue. You don't see it very often. But here's an example in the trachea. So why they say it's one layer is because if you look, and here's the tricky part, if this is your basement membrane, a dark line, and I start seeing these tall columnar cells, look, there's a nucleus, there's a nucleus, there's a nucleus, here's a nucleus, there's one. But the ones that have very narrow bottoms, will take their nucleus and push it up. There's not enough room at the bottom for it, so it's kind of squeezed up. And most people, when they look at a tissue, they just look for the nucleus to identify where the tissue's at. So it looks like there's a layer of tissue there, cells there, and a layer of cells in that part of the tissue. But because every one of these cells touch the basement membrane, it's actually only one layer. It's pseudostratified. It's a false layer at the top. So in the airway, you can see all these little tiny structures called cilia that come off the top, like hairs. You're constantly waving in your airway to take things like bacteria or dust particles or pollen and move them up and away. So we'll look at a piece of trachea. Stratified. And then here's just kind of what I drew. But you can see they all touch along the basement membrane on the bottom. Here's a layer of nuclei. There's another layer of nuclei, but they're still all just one cell thick. Sometimes you get these little things called goblet cells that make mucus, and we'll talk about those a lot that are in here. So like in your airway, you make mucus that the bacteria sticks in, and then the cilia can move it up. Looks like many layers, but it's not. It's one layer. Right. Now the stratified groups. What does stratified mean? Yeah, multiple layers. So stratified squamous, we're going to see this a lot on Monday when we talk about epithelium. But stratified squamous It's lots and lots of layers all the way up. Here's the trick. At the bottom of this, they usually look cuboidal. The fresh, living, healthy cells are cube-shaped. But after you put the weight of all the other cells on top of it, they start flattening out. So as these cells rise, they get flatter and flatter and flatter and flatter. Another thing about the skin is the closer to the surface of the body, they also get more what? Dead. More dead? They become dead. So they start dying. Because what do you know about epithelium? It's a what? A vascular. There are no blood vessels in it. So all the nutrients, the oxygen, the glucose, down here where the blood vessels are, these are the cells that are getting the nutrients, oxygen and sugars. All these cells up here are doing what then if they're too far away from food? They're starving to death. Yeah, they're dying. And then they'll flake off. So down deep in here you have connective tissue with blood vessels running through it. Here's the very bottom layer of epithelium, kind of weaves back and forth. And then here you can see nice round nuclei, but as you get up closer to the surface, they get flattened out, they get smashed, and then eventually you don't see nuclei at all. Guess what's happened to the cells? They've died. They can't sustain life, and they can't sustain that nucleus. So the main purpose of many layers of flat is protection. Palms of the hand, palms of the feet, all of your skin, GI tract. And then we're going to talk about this in integument next week, but here's just a layer of skin. And you see the dark bottom basement. All these cells are perfectly tightly packed. Another layer, another layer, another layer, and eventually those nuclei all die and have all these somewhat transparent cells. And we'll talk about keratinized and non-keratinized skin later. Keratin is just a waterproofing protein that makes it strong and waterproof. So you have places in your body that are keratinized that have lots of keratin and have others that are not very keratinized. And we'll worry about this when we talk about skin. But we'll take a piece of scalp, human scalp, and we'll have it on a slide and look at that too. Stratified cuboidal, how many layers? Two or more. And they're cube-shaped. So as an example with this, here you have a nice round lumen, hollow tube, with a stratified cuboidal around the outside. So it needs to be a strong tube in this situation. So something like a salivary gland in your mouth that secretes right into a hostile or toxic environment has to have this strong structure. They make things like enzymes, make mucus, and they push it out into the tube, and it slides in your mouth or squirts if you've ever gleeked. Same idea. But we'll do the same thing. We'll talk about the mammary gland. We'll get to those too. And then the ovary. So one of the things that we'll look at is the ovary. So here, you've got an egg. All around the egg, you have to have protective cells because, I don't know if you knew this or not, but if you're a woman, you've had all the eggs in your body that you'll ever have, ever, in you before you were even born. So from the time you were born, you've actually been losing eggs, or eggs have been dying, or there's something wrong with them, they're getting killed off. So that by the time you even hit puberty, you've lost millions and millions of eggs. So by the time you're born, you have more eggs in your body than you'll ever have. Men, for the number of eggs that you have, by the time you hit puberty, we're throwing out a batch of those a day. So constantly making them. But protective structures that feed that egg, they nurture the egg, they keep it warm and cuddle it at night, but they protect it. And you can see a cube after a cube after a cube after a cube, and then another layer of the same things. Stratified columnar, and we have one left. So stratified columnar, they're column shaped, but always look at the surface. It's just like when I said with stratified squamous. It doesn't matter if the surface is kind of square. The further you get up, that's what's important. Always look at the top layer to identify what shape it is. So even if it starts off square here and becomes flat, it's always the flat one at the top, squamous. Same with columnar. The bottom ones are kind of square, cube-shaped, but the top ones are columnar. And the place we'll look at that, the urethra in the body for urination. It's thick and it's also protective. So here you can see more than one layer. There's a cell, a nice columnar cell, sitting on top of what looks like a flat cube. And you see the pattern over and over again. column on a cube, column on a cube, column on a cube. If this is a large open area, the basement membrane sits where there's other tissue. So the basement membrane would be down here. And you can see that these nuclei have a tendency to sit closer to the basement membrane. Just like this over here. And then transitional epithelium. And what was the special thing about this epithelium? Yeah, it changes. It changes shape. So it can adapt. Like, for instance, in the bladder, in the urethra. Ureters. So the bladder stretches. And it, one time it can look like it's more cuboidal, another time it looks like it's more squamous or even columnar. So anywhere you have a lot of stretching and pulling. Transitions. We'll get that tomorrow, too. So when you're looking tomorrow in the lab and you're studying microscope slides, you're going to have to draw most of these. When you draw them, just draw them so that you could identify them in a lineup. So something like this, if I saw a stack of these, how would I describe them since they're a stack first? Stratified. And then what shape would I give them? How do you know? What layer are you looking for? The top layer. Yep, cube shape. In this situation, it doesn't matter because they're all cube shaped. But how about this one? This is showing you kind of a three-dimensional perspective. Here's the layer, and then you can see the layer behind it. So it would be like sitting like this. Yep, there's only one layer, simple, and columnar. How about this one over here? Stratified and squamous, right, the top layer, even though it's a cube at the bottom. How about this one? Yep, pseudo-stratified. Because in this one, it looks like they're more than one layer because of the lines of the nucleus, but in reality, every one of them touched the basement membrane. I want you to look at those. Oops, sorry. I guess it's time for me to wake up. Whew, go for that. So, the glands. The glands we talked about before, exocrine glands and endocrine glands, the way that they bend, so here it's exposed to the outside of the body. Here it's kind of isolated off and it pushes towards what? Endocrine always try and push something towards the blood, yeah, blood vessels. So they all start as a simple sheet. They start bulking up or bending around, and then what they do in their final step, if it forms a superficial or external area, is exocrine. If it stays within, it actually clips itself off and stays near the blood vessels, is endocrine. So some of the times we'll talk about this, like in the thyroid gland. Thyroid gland releases hormones into the body, so what would it be, exo or endo? Endo. Yep. The liver, this is a tricky one. The liver actually has a tube that pushes stuff out into the GI tract, which pushes out to the body. What would that be? Or out of the body. Exo. And that's going to be a tricky one that a lot of people don't realize, is that your GI tract is actually considered an external environment. The inside of the tube, the lumen, is external. So you can eat bacteria. As long as it stays into that environment, usually it's not harmful. And a special type of cell you see dispersed around epithelium a lot are called goblet cells. It's a special type of cells. They make mucus. So make a little substance, an enzyme called mucin, and then they add water to it, and it makes a slimy mucus. It's there for protection and lubrication. So here's an electron microscope picture. You can see its nucleus in the middle, and all these little secretory vesicles where it's pushing the mucus out. And there's the cartoon version of it. I am actually going to skip over these, so you can review them, but I'm not going to test you over them. When you look at exocrine glands, their shapes can be significant. For this class, we're not going to talk all that much about the shapes. But you see here, it forms a duct that pushes outside the body. It can curl up. It can branch off. It can branch with more branches. It can make a nice round structure. So when we need these terms, we'll actually come back and talk to them. But in general, I'm not going to test you over that. And then the last thing are tissue membranes. So I kind of mentioned this a little bit when we talked about the different cavities in the body. But here are tissue membranes. Membranes are made out of epithelium. They're a protective sheet-like covering. So serous membranes are what I talked about when I said it lying in the body. When we talked about, what was the name of that sac around the heart? Anybody remember? Pericardial sac. Yep, serous membranes. It's filled with a fluid called serous fluid. The one allowed in the lungs are called the pleural membranes. They're serous. Mucous membranes, places like the mouth, the vagina, inside the penis, and the urethra. Mucous membranes obviously make what? Mucus, yep. They're for lubrication, to help move things, capture debris. So we'll talk about those. Synovial is referring to joints. So everywhere you have a joint, you have the synovial membrane. So like this, here's a bone, here's a bone. You have that water-filled pocket here. You have a lining that holds all the water in, like a water balloon. And the last one, the cutaneous membranes, that would be referring to the skin. So protective covering. Definitely go back and review your body cavities and make sure you know the terms for those different serous membranes. What do you call this entire cavity, whether where it holds the thorax, the abdomen, and the pelvis? Anybody remember that whole area? It's all the front part. It's on the anterior side. There's another word for anterior, by the way, that actually describes this whole cavity all the way across, all these separate cavities combined. Ventral, yep, ventral cavities. What do you call the one that's the brain and spinal cord? The dorsal. So, okay, huh? They'll keep popping up, so I'll randomly put questions like that in there to help you remember. And then we just kind of looked at this. So here are a couple of different membranes. What would this one be? The skin. Cutaneous.
Yep.
How about this one that makes a slimy, slick coating? Mucus. Yep. So the duodenum is the first part of the small intestine. And obviously that mucous membrane is there to help propel food through and help food slide and protect the wall. And then this is the heart. So what is that? Serous. And what's the name of this sac that goes around the heart? You just mentioned it a few minutes ago. It's the pericardial. Yeah. And then the skin. We're going to talk a lot about the skin on Monday, but the skin, the cutaneous membrane, just lots and lots of layers. It's there for protection. It's different than the other membranes because it's actually exposed to air and doesn't have a wet area. The other membranes do. Serous fluid, synovial fluid, mucus, they're all wet. The mucous membranes, anywhere you find mucus, so in your nose, in your mouth, all the way down your airway, pretty much everywhere that has exposure to the outside, but you're trying to get something in your body, has a mucous membrane. So all the way through the GI tract, from mouth to anus, the lungs, the airway, the reproductive tract, all mucous membranes. And then just different pictures. Here's stomach mucosa. Remember, that's external, technically. So external exposure, but you still have that slimy covering. Right. And the mucus is there to trap things, to help propel things, help things move a lot better. The serous membranes, you usually find a serous membrane inside one of the body cavities. It doesn't have any exposure to the outside. And another thing about serous membranes is they're all filled with fluids. They're called serous fluids. So one of the cavities, we just mentioned the pericardial, we've mentioned the pleural. Another one's called the peritoneum, and the peritoneum covers all of the abdominal pelvic organs. So it would be in this red. You can see it's continuous, it goes all the way along, it doesn't break. It comes down, it folds around, comes back over, weaves up and down around each of the intestines. So everywhere you have an intestinal tubing, this sac wraps around it. It allows the intestines to move freely across each other, like when you're digesting and processing food. And then I already mentioned the pleura and the pericardial sac. And that's why we're stopping, because it is 2 minutes over. Sorry about that, but thanks for your patience. I'll see you tomorrow. Don't forget, what are you not allowed to wear tomorrow in lab?